Good morning. It is a wonderful morning to worship our Lord and Savior this morning. I'm so glad you're here. Glad you are here to worship the Lord together with us. Today the theme is Christ We Proclaim, and excited about singing about Jesus our Savior today. Would you stand with me? I'd like to invite you to actually stand for the entire duration of the singing time this morning. Some of you might think, boy, that I'm not sure I can do that. And so here's my caveat. If you at any point need to sit down, feel free to do so. No one will look at you funny, but feel free to stand the entire time. It helps us sing better practically, but also it's a good way to intentionally show our worship of Jesus Christ. We're going to look this morning at Colossians chapter 1. Christ We Proclaim is the theme. And yet so often we are afraid to proclaim Christ. And I think sometimes the reason we are afraid to proclaim his name is because we do not truly see him in all of his glory for who he is. You know, in order for us to really proclaim the name of Jesus Christ, we must first know his name and we must worship him. So I'd like to read a passage of scripture from Colossians 1, verses 15 through 19. And then a few verses following this very passage, the passage says, "Him we proclaim." So let's look at the person that we are here to worship this morning. Colossians 1:15 says, "He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things. And in him, all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. For in him, all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, making peace by the blood of his cross. Him we proclaim." Let's sing together about the Christ that we are to proclaim this morning.
God, as we come before you today, we do so with the desire to acknowledge who you are, that you are truly the one and only almighty, holy God of heaven who created this earth and everything in it. There is no one like you. And God, you are much, much, much greater than us. There is no comparison. And God, help us to see you today for the God that you are. Help us to humbly acknowledge who we are before you. That if we have put our faith and trust in Jesus, that we are just sinners saved by grace. God, I pray that you would help us as we acknowledge you to worship you appropriately and rightly and wholeheartedly today. And as we have sung, God, it is our desire today, as well as each and every moment that you give us breath as we go throughout our week, is to proclaim Christ. That we could say, along with the Apostle Paul, that for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. That Christ is our life. And God, I pray that we would not just give lip service to that, but that would be reality. Oh God, I pray that you'd be lifted up and honored, and that the gospel and Christ would be proclaimed in this service today. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to stay standing here for a few moments.
It also requires that we commit ourselves to what Christ has called us to. So this next song is a call to commitment. And thankfully, there is grace for this commitment. That as we commit ourselves to the message of Jesus Christ, he gives us his word and he gives us his spirit. So let's call together to each other, come all Christians, be committed. Jesus saw the crowds. He said they were as sheep without a shepherd, and he felt compassion on them. And if we are going to have that same compassion, we must gaze upon his cross. So let's pray together for that same compassion.
There is an everlasting you have born.
seated. This next song may be new to many of you, so the ensemble is going to sing it together. But as you begin to learn it throughout the song, I encourage you to start singing along. That's sometimes the best way to learn a song, is by singing along. So as you learn it, begin to sing. As we sing, let the nations be glad.
Singing this morning. What a joy it is to sing together about the Lord Jesus Christ. At this time, our children can be dismissed, ages 3 through the 3rd grade, to junior church. They will be learning about Jeroboam, how Jeroboam sets up a golden calf and rebels against the Lord, and the Lord's response to that. And so we'll pray for them here in just a second, for their hearts to be impacted by the word. And we're going to read the word of the Lord together. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 1 through 6 is the reading this morning. 1 Thessalonians 2, If you are using your pew Bible this morning, or if you don't have the Bible on your device, it's page 927, 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. This is the word of the Lord. For you yourselves know, brothers, that our coming to you was not in vain. But though we had already suffered and been shamefully treated at Philippi, as you know, we had boldness in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in the midst of much conflict. For our appeal does not spring from error or impurity or any attempt to deceive, but just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak, not to please man, but to please God, who tests our hearts. For we never came with words of flattery, as you know, nor with a pretext for greed. God is witness. Nor did we seek glory from people, whether from you or from others, though we could have made demands as apostles of Christ. Let's pray together. Our Father, as we humbly approach your word, we ask that you would root out any sin or impurity in our hearts, that you would help us to confess and to repent, and that you would help us as a church this morning that we would respond to your word with obedience and faith. We pray for Pastor Todd as he preaches, that you would give him the strength and the grace that he needs to proclaim the gospel boldly and accurately. We pray for our junior church teachers as they teach the word of God, that you would help them to be accurate. We pray that you would soften the hearts of the children in those various places. We pray that you would do a work on our hearts today. Please melt our hearts under the preaching of your word and help us to respond. Help us not to go away with hard hearts, but help us instead to respond in obedience. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. Oh, what a blessing it is to come to God's word once again, and may I remind us that this indeed is God's word that we're looking at here today. It bears power and authority over us as we gather here. Well, last week, we looked at chapter 1 and really made our way through a good section of chapter 1 after that introductory section. And really, Paul was talking about the nature of the gospel, how that they gave the gospel with power, and that power was with the Holy Spirit of God providing that power and with full conviction. And as we looked at last week, I really believe that full conviction was that Paul and Silas and Timothy, they themselves were the ones that were convinced that they had the truth and that there was power in that truth. There was the acceptance of the gospel, and how as the Thessalonian individuals accepted the gospel, that they became imitators of Paul and Silas and Timothy, but not only imitators of them, but of the Lord as well. And then the effects of the gospel. They were brothers. They were loved by God. They were chosen. And then they had a testimony. There was a testimony of influence, so much so that Paul says we didn't have to say anything, that all throughout the region of Macedonia and Achaia that there was proclaimed, hey, something's going on over there in Thessalonica, and this is what the reports are like. And then, of course, their proclamation of the gospel. They were, in turn, giving the gospel, and great things were happening. And so as the gospel was spread, God was working. Is that any different today? Any different at all? Do we believe that? That as the gospel is spread, God will work. God saves people in 2022 just like he did in this section of God's word that we're looking at. Amen? God's gospel has power today, just as much as it did in this particular time that we're looking at with the Apostle Paul. So today I want us to look at, in chapter 2, verses 1 through 6, in the section that was read here this morning, how ministry should be done. How ministry should be done. You know, with projects and different things that we do, at least in my opinion, it's not just the fact that it gets done, but how it gets done. Recently, my son, last few months, Jonathan, got married, and he and his wife have just gotten into a house, and a few weeks ago, I went up to help them do some painting. And you know, you quickly realize when you go into an older home that there's some people that just shouldn't paint. They just shouldn't. Because we spent a lengthy amount of time scraping drips off of the drywall, sanding things down, door frames that, were stained but just hammered with paint, and it's just as though somebody said, oh, the job got done, but they really didn't care how it got done. You know, God is concerned that the job gets done, but he's also concerned with how it gets done. So let's look at God's Word and see how we can understand better how ministry should be done. I don't know if you remember this, but some time back I gave you a definition of ministry. And it went something like this. Ministry is using my time, my talents, my giftedness, and my resources for the honor and glory of God by serving others. To the honor and glory of God, I want to use my time, my giftedness, my resources to serve other people for God's honor and for God's glory. That is ministry. So we start out here with verse 1 of chapter 2, and Paul says, for. So what's he connecting this to? It's likely he's connecting it really to the entirety of verses 2 through 10 of chapter 1, but probably specifically verse 5. Because our gospel came to you not in word only, not only in word, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit with full conviction, and you know what kind of men we prove to be among you for your sake. So I think he's tying it back to that thought process specifically and fleshing that out a little bit further. And first of all, I want us to notice this morning that ministry for God matters. Ministry for God matters. He says, for you yourselves, you know. You weren't the ones who just heard about what happened in Thessalonica. You were there. You experienced it. You were the recipients of it. You know. First-hand knowledge, first-hand experience, brothers, that our coming to you was not in vain. Our coming to you. Remember just a couple of weeks ago when we started this series, I mentioned to you that it was over a 1,300-mile trek for Paul to get to Thessalonica. He started out in Jerusalem. He went up to Antioch. He passed through Asia Minor. He crossed the Aegean Sea. He ended up in Philippi, where he got beat, and we'll talk a little bit more about that here in just a moment. He eventually made his way another 100 miles or so to Thessalonica. He came. Let's not overlook that. There was some action in that. There was some intention in that. He purposefully came by God's direction to Thessalonica with a whole lot of effort that went into that. He says that our coming to you was what? It was not in vain. It was not hollow. It was not empty. It was not void of value. How, at least in part, do we know that? Well, look back at verse 9 in chapter 1. For they themselves report concerning us the kind of reception we had among you and how you turned. The idea is really of repented. you had a change of not only mind, but also direction. You turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. He says, you know that because some of you experienced that. You saw it in the lives of others. You know that our coming to you was not in vain. It was not hollow. It was not empty. There was God's blessing. You know, Paul reiterated this in 1 Corinthians 15:58. That whole chapter about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the resurrection that will be future for you and me. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable. The idea is literally to be seated, to be settled, to be motionless, to be anchored, always abounding in the work of the Lord. Really entails the idea of overflowing, or if this is somehow even possible, overdoing. I don't think we can ever overdo our service to the Lord. But he's saying, hey, be settled, be immovable, always just overdoing, overflowing in your service to the Lord. And what's the end result? Knowing that your labor is not what? In vain. Exact same word. It's not in vain. Do we sometimes possibly think that our labor is in vain? Yes, we do. We can humanly look at, you know, whatever ministry we might be doing, and on any given day just kind of wonder, does this matter at all? Is anything coming of this? I've taught this class for 20 years, 25 years, 30 years. Does it matter? Does it matter that I work in the nursery? Does it matter that I work and serve in the parking lot on a service? Does it matter that I work in Truth Trackers? It matters. It matters. When ministry is done with a right motive, a right spirit, just to honor and please God, it matters. And God uses our ministry, and sometimes in ways we don't even know. But it matters. It matters that we stay faithful. And God is pleased. It's not in vain. It's not useless. It's not empty. It's not hollow. And Paul was pointing to that. He's saying, look, when we came there, there was things happening. We don't always see that in ministry. We don't always see the immediate results. But if in any way, shape, or form you're struggling this morning, you're discouraged this morning, you're wondering, does my ministry really matter? If you're doing it with the right motives and a right spirit, it matters. As we'll see here in just a moment, particularly if you're doing it with a motive just to please and honor God, it matters. But secondly, Paul says this, ministry for God requires perseverance. It requires perseverance. He says, but though we had already suffered. That word suffered refers to primarily physical abuse. And he says, and had been shamefully treated at Philippi. Well, what happened at Philippi? Well, in Acts 16, we find out that the magistrates tore the garments off of them and gave orders to beat them with rods. What are rods? It just truly means a long, stiff stick. Maybe we would think of it as something like a broom handle. And it says, when they had inflicted many blows upon them, they threw them into prison, ordering the jailer to keep them safely. He says, you know, we suffered physical abuse at Philippi. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, just the chapter over, verses 3 and 4, Paul says this, that no one be moved. He's concerned that they're going to be shaken by persecution and afflictions. He says that no one be moved by these afflictions. For you yourselves know that we are destined for this. For when we were with you, we kept telling you beforehand that we were to suffer affliction, just as it has come to pass, and just as you know. Now, is that we there, that we are destined, is that exclusive just to Paul, Silas, and Timothy, or is that inclusive of all believers? And it's probably both. He's referring to himself, he's referring to Silas, and he's really referring to all believers in Jesus Christ, because he writes in 2 Timothy 3:12, indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Now, what happens if we do suffer some type of persecution? What is typical for us? We view that as being atypical, right? Hey, this is not norm. When really Paul says to Timothy, hey, if you're living a godly life for Christ Jesus, hey, you can expect it. It's coming. In some way, in some shape, in some form, it is coming, and you will be persecuted for your faith. Paul is addressing the Ephesian elders in Acts 20, and he says this, and now, behold, I'm going to Jerusalem, constrained by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy Spirit testifies to me in every city that imprisonment and afflictions await me. How would you like that prescription? Hey, wherever I go, there's going to be imprisonment, there's going to be afflictions. But I do not count my life of any value, nor as precious to myself, if only I may finish my course and the ministry that I receive from the Lord Jesus to testify to the gospel of the grace of God. Paul says, look, I know this is not going to be an easy road. In fact, I know for certain that persecution awaits me, afflictions await me, imprisonment awaits me. That's coming. That's just a given. But with all of that, I just want to finish well. I want to hear Jesus say, well done, good and faithful servant. And he pressed on. He persevered. And then he says, and we've been shamefully treated at Philippi. This word shamefully has the idea of public disgrace. They were publicly dishonored. They were publicly humiliated, truly unlawfully beaten. I think I may have mentioned this briefly, but as you read in Acts 16, that the next morning after they had been beaten, the earthquake came, the jail cells opened, the magistrates just sent word, hey, you guys can go. And Paul sends back word and says, no. You unlawfully beat and imprisoned Roman citizens. You come and you personally deal with this. You know, he wasn't just going to say, hey, you can just kind of sneak out of the city without anybody noticing, but he wanted them to come and personally deal with it. Peter tells us this in 1 Peter 5:10. And after you have suffered a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. Isn't that great? He's saying, look, you're going to suffer a little while here on this earth. And when it's all done, you're going to spend eternity with Christ. But in the here and the now, in the midst of persecution, Christ himself will restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. Praise God for that. Praise God that that's what Christ does in the midst of suffering, in the midst of even being publicly humiliated and shamed as Paul and Silas were. And at the end of verse 2, he says that it was all in the midst of much conflict. He says, as you know, we all had boldness in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in the midst of much conflict. The idea of intense opposition. As missionaries, they really underwent intense, intense opposition all along the way. You know, we from time to time read stories like Jim Elliot of missionaries gone by in past years and his four friends and companions who were all killed while serving Jesus Christ. And we read stories like that and, you know, are can I say it in the right way, impressed with their faithfulness. Do you know how it typically works for a missionary, at least in my experience and being with and talking to missionaries? It's just going to wherever God has called them, to whatever place in the world, and in the midst of being under-supported sometimes, dealing with cancer, dealing with a variety of illnesses, dealing with opposition, dealing with a guard who's needed outside their home from 6 p.m. to 6 a.m. so thieves don't come in and steal stuff, an armed guard. It's dealing with a myriad of discouragements and uncertainties, not the least of which is, I wonder after 30 years if there'll be anybody who'll come behind me and continue this work. And in the midst of all of that stuff, and some of it is the same stuff that you and I deal with in our lives, they just do it in a different place in the world, that they just keep on keeping on. That's what perseverance looks like. That's what perseverance looks like in the life of a missionary, just being faithful for 20, 25, 30, 35, 40 years, just saying, hey, through the midst of all this stuff, I'm just going to keep on plugging and I'm going to keep on serving God. And all of that is not in vain. It's not empty. It's not hollow. And Paul says this, we had boldness in our God to declare to you the gospel of God. We had boldness in our God. You know, I don't know what your opinion of the Apostle Paul is, but as I see Paul in the New Testament, if I had to have a mental image of Paul, he was one who was just bold 24/7. Just kind of like a lion, never fearful, never afraid, you know, just always after it. But that is not what the Bible tells us. That there were times where he needed to ask for boldness. What do we mean by boldness? What's biblical boldness? I think it's something like this. It's confidence, it's courage, and conviction regarding truth, regarding the gospel, regarding God's word. Coupled with a willingness to speak straightforward truth. It's confidence in God, not you and me. It's confidence in God. It is courage. It is a conviction, just as Paul speaks of in verse 5 of chapter 1. It's conviction that we have truth. And then it is a willingness to straightforwardly proclaim that truth. That's boldness. It's a willingness to lovingly, compassionately, and yet forthrightly say to someone, you are a sinner. And apart from faith in Christ, your sin will condemn you to an eternal hell. That's boldness. Now, boldness should not be confused with being harsh, hot-headed, overbearing, rash, or arrogant. That's not boldness. That's just being foolish. But boldness, even if it doesn't mesh with your personality, is just a confidence in God, a courage to step up, a conviction that I have the truth, and a willingness to speak that truth forthrightly. That is boldness. You know, in Acts chapter 4, Peter and John healed a man. They were preaching, and they got in big trouble. And they were told, hey, you can't do this. You can't preach anymore. And that's where they boldly declared that we must obey God rather than men. And at the end of verse 13 of chapter 4, let me just back up and include verse 12. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. That was what Peter was preaching. And now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and common men, they were astonished and they recognized that they had been with Jesus. What tipped them off? They were doing the same things that Jesus did. They were proclaiming the gospel. They were doing it forthrightly. They were doing it with courage. They were doing it with conviction. And they were perceived as being bold. But right after that, just the same chapter, they have a prayer meeting. And now, Lord, look upon their threats and grant to your servants to continue to speak your word with all boldness. You know, they didn't have this experience and say, ha, we've got it now. You know, we're on track. We've got this bold thing, and we're just plowing ahead. They realized they were frail. They were inept, just like you and me. They were weak. And so they come to God, and they say, God, would you please help us to continue to speak with all boldness while you stretch out your hand to heal, and signs and wonders are performed through the name of your holy servant Jesus. And when they had prayed, the place in which they were gathered together was shaken. I've always wondered what it would be like to be in a prayer meeting where the building shook. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And what happened? And they continued to speak the word with boldness. Not in their own strength, but relying upon the strength and the power of God to proclaim truth with courage and conviction and just an unadulterated willingness to speak the truth. Ephesians 6, 19 and 20, Paul is asking the Ephesian believers to pray for him. And it says, and also for me, would you pray for me that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel. Paul was not a guy who just felt like inherently he had boldness and it was just kind of flowing out of him. He's saying, hey, would you pray for me that I would have boldness? If Paul was asking others to pray for him in that way, I would think that would be a legitimate way for us to pray for one another and really pray for ourselves. God, would you give me boldness? Would you help me to step up with courage, with conviction, with confidence in you, and forthrightly speak truth? What is Proverbs 29 and verse 25? The fear of man brings what? A snare. But whoever trusts in the Lord will be safe. And it's really a matter of fear versus faith. Will I trust God? Will my confidence be in God? Maybe my personality, I'm just naturally a little timid. Maybe I'm a little backward. It's not my personality just to kind of step up and step out and speak forthrightly. But God, in this situation, this is what needs to be done. And would you give me the grace, would you give me the boldness to step up and do what is necessary? And I dare say that's where most of us find ourselves. That we're not naturally, by character, just bold people. We need God's boldness to speak for him. Well, thirdly, let's notice this morning that ministry for God requires the absence of sinful characteristics, the absence of sinful characteristics. Paul says in verse 3, "For our appeal does not spring from error or impurity or any attempt to deceive." Our appeal, it's the idea of our urgent cry. It's really the response to their message. It's an appeal or a call. He's looking for a response. And our response to all of this does not flow out of, does not spring from, first of all, error. This is really in contrast to false teachers. He's saying false teachers, they are teaching error. There is doctrinal heresy. We are giving you unvarnished truth from God. There is no error in our message, and it does not flow out of error. It flows out of that full conviction, chapter 1, verse 5, that what we have is truth from God. And he says it doesn't flow out of impurity. Now, this word impurity could be connected and contrasting in some way with the pagan religions who are characterized by immoral behavior of all sorts. Or it could be just simply that Paul is saying, in an ethical sense, there is integrity. There's nothing wrong or underhanded that characterized Paul's ministry. Ethically, he was above board. You know, when we think of these two particular traits, that there was no error, there was no impurity, that's precisely what we strive to do here at our church. I'm sure we do so at times imperfectly, but we strive to do it and we work at it. That we give God's truth just as He has written it. And it would be my desire that if Jesus were sitting in this service, that afterwards He could say, you know, you said it just like it should have been said. You said it just as it was written. That's what we are striving for, that there is no error, but that we are staying true to God's word, that there is no impurity. If you take it in the sense of having good ethics, that as a church, in all of our dealings, we strive to be above board, if I can say it that way. That we want to do things rightly and properly in ministry. If something requires a permit, we get a permit. We don't try to skirt around things, go under things, go over things. We just simply try to do it right with an ethical integrity about it. That's how ministry should be done. It's not something under the table or trying to skirt around things, but it just is done rightly and properly. And Paul thirdly says, hey, there was no deceit. Really, this term comes from the picture of fishing bait, of putting bait on a hook to catch a fish. And Paul's saying, look, this is not what we're doing. This is not a trap. This is not a trick. We're not giving you something. We're not putting some bait out there and then doing what we would call the bait and switch. He's saying that's not it at all. That's not it at all. We are just simply giving you truth. Peter describes it this way. He describes false teachers in 2 Peter 2 as those who entice by sensual passions. And Paul's saying, no, we're not doing that. We're not in any way attempting to deceive you. Because he goes on to say in verse 4, we've been approved by God. That's a good approval, wouldn't you say? We've been approved by God. It's the idea we've been tested, we've been found valid, we've been found approved by God. And because of that, we've been entrusted with the gospel. It comes from the word to believe, and therefore implying trust. God believed in them. He trusted them. He entrusted them with the gospel. And it was God's doing. In 1 Timothy 1:11-12. He says, in accordance with the gospel of the glory of the blessed God with which I have been entrusted, I thank him who has given me strength, Christ Jesus our Lord, because he has judged me faithful, appointing me to his service. You know, and in a very real sense, any one of us who is a believer in Jesus Christ has been entrusted with the gospel. We are to be good stewards of the gospel. You know, there have been various times, as probably we've all experienced in our life and in my life, where someone has asked you to, you know, kind of watch a pet for them, house sit for them, you know, hey, let you borrow a car, you know, you've babysat their children. There's an entrusting there. You know, and it's a big deal. I remember one time somebody, as my kids were pretty young, they said, hey, would you keep our fish for us while we're on vacation? We were scared to death that fish was going to die, you know. And it was like, oh, please, God, don't let this fish die, you know, while they're gone, you know. And particularly, you know, it kind of ramps up when you're watching someone's children. You know, you're just, that's a huge entrusting. Somebody lets you borrow a vehicle, you know, it's just like, Lord, please don't let anything happen, you know, while I'm borrowing this vehicle, because I've been entrusted with this. And we feel that way rightly with things and people. But do we feel that way with the gospel? Do we feel this urging inside of us of, hey, I've been entrusted with the best news in all of the world, and it is incumbent upon me to share that with others, and I have got to protect this and value this and use it and proclaim it. It's been entrusted to us. And I think this gets back to the boldness, but in verse 4, Paul says, so we speak. We're not silent. We're not just sitting on our hands. We're speaking the gospel, not to please man, but to please God who tests our hearts. We speak. Galatians 1:10, Paul writes this, For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ. You know, folks, when it comes to ministry, when it comes to giving the gospel, this is kind of where the rubber meets the road. Am I trying to please people, or am I trying to please God? Do I refrain from giving the gospel because I'm just convinced that it won't be well received? Somebody's going to be upset. Somebody will make fun of me. Maybe several somebodies will make fun of me. I will be the outcast. Or with boldness, that courage and confidence and conviction to forthrightly speak truth, do we step up and say, I want to please God. I want to please God. And as I've told you before, sometimes that comes with a sweaty palm and a dry mouth and a whole lot of uncertainty, and it's just taking that step of God. The fear of man is a snare, but I will trust in you. That's a safe place to be. And God, I just want to please you. You know, that's where we need to live, folks. That's where we need to live. God, I just want to please you. I'm not worried about what other people think. And that's a struggle. It's a struggle for all of us. Let's just be honest. We're humans. I like people to like me. I don't like to be disliked. I don't like people mad at me, angry at me, making fun of me. None of us do. If you do, there's probably something not quite right. We like people to like us, but at the end of the day, we have to say, am I just pleasing people or am I pleasing God? And by God's grace, may we be motivated to please Him over pleasing people. Now, we don't have to unnecessarily cause problems. That can happen. Sometimes our manner and our method is just not correct. We need to be gracious. We need to be compassionate. We need to be kind, but forthright with the gospel. He goes on to say in verse 5, there was no flattery. You know, we didn't come to you with this smooth speech. We didn't come to you kind of laying accolades upon you. So literally the idea of the word is to have power or authority over you. He's saying we didn't come in that way. And he says, you know that. Nor did we come with a pretext or a pretense for greed. The idea is to put a mask on and cover our motivation of greed. You know, we didn't come to you, say, you know, pretending to be something we're not. We didn't come to you with the motivation of greed, but looking like humble servants. They were just humble servants. They didn't have some motivation to get money from these folks, get prestige from these folks. They didn't have any of that. They just wanted to give them the gospel of Jesus Christ. And he says in verse 6, there was no pride. He says, we did not seek glory from people, whether from you or from others. He says, now we could have made demands as apostles of Christ. Now I think this is apostles not in the narrow sense for Paul himself, one who saw Christ and was commissioned by Christ, but I think it's probably in a broader sense that included Silas and Timothy. He said we could have argued, hey, because of who we are as ministers of God, that we need to be treated and served in a certain way. But he said we didn't do that. This was not about us. You know, we've got to be careful in ministry that it doesn't become about us. Do we get upset when we don't get a thank you? Are we perturbed when we're not recognized? Now, I think gratitude, appreciation, thank yous, recognition, it's all needed. It helps. But what's our motivation when we're just ministering along 5, 10, 15, just kind of continue the math, however many years, and the pats on the back, the applause, it doesn't come? Are we agitated by that? Are we frustrated by that? Are we discouraged by that? Or is our motivation, God, I just want to please you. God, I just want to honor you. God, I just want to keep plugging. Even when the applause and the accolades and the thank yous don't necessarily come. And let me underscore one more time, the thank you should come. We should be appreciative. We should be grateful for the service that people do. We should communicate that. But when they don't come, what's our spirit? What's our attitude? And I think it's revealing about our motives in our service for Jesus Christ. Let me close with this verse. 2 Corinthians 2:17, Paul says this, for we are not like so many peddlers of God's word, really con men, pretending to be servants of Christ, but as men of sincerity. It's the idea, the word picture of holding something up to the sun, examining it, and it being true or worthy or valuable. As commissioned by God in the sight of God, we speak Christ. We speak in Christ. We speak the gospel. We speak the truth of God. So how should ministry be done? In this short text, I believe Paul says and reminds us, ministry for God matters. It's not in vain. Ministry for God, it requires some perseverance. Just keep plugging along. Just keep on keeping on, and ministry for God requires the absence of some sinful characteristics. There's no error. There is no impurity. There's no deceit. It's not all about flattery. It's not about greed. It's not about pride or arrogance or us, we could say. It's simply about us faithfully serving Jesus Christ with a right spirit, a right attitude, and giving Him the honor and glory along the way. That's how ministry should be done. And by God's grace, I pray that that'll be continually ever the case here in our church as a whole, and for us as individuals, that that's how we value and view ministry. God, I pray that You would help us this morning as we respond to Your truth. God, it could be that there are some here this morning that they're weary in well-doing. They're just tired. Even wondering, hey, does this make any difference? And God, I pray that You would just encourage their hearts today and realize, help them to realize that ministry done with a right motive, a right spirit, in a right way is not in vain. It's not in vain. God, help us to realize this morning that ministry does require perseverance. As Paul said, in the midst of much conflict, that we keep on keeping on. Lord, help us to do that. Lord, if there's some here today that are just tempted to kind of throw in the towel and be done and quit, oh God, I pray that You'd encourage them to keep persevering. And Lord, by Your grace, I pray that as we minister, we would do so with doctrinal purity, with no error, with ethical purity and integrity, that there would be no deceit, that we're not trying to get a crowd by flattery or smooth talk, that we're not enamored with greed, and that we're not all about us. We're just about Christ. Lord, this is a tall order. Our flesh gets in the way and really messes this up sometimes. But, oh God, I pray that we would faithfully walk in the Spirit, and that this would be a reality for us individually and collectively as a church. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Just for a quick moment, with your heads bowed and your eyes closed, how's God speaking to you today? Sometimes we say it this way, that God through His Word kind of put His finger on something in your life or your heart. Has He done that today? Has He identified something that just needs correcting, maybe confessing a sin? It could be that you would say, hey, I'm not perfect, but you know, I really believe I'm in this vein. I'm really striving to do what Paul was doing, and maybe it's just a matter of, God, by Your grace, help me to keep on keeping on. Maybe just asking God for grace to do that. Maybe, just maybe, today that you're watching via live stream, you're here in this room, and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior. That's your greatest need today. If we can help you with that, if we can sit down and show you from God's Word how you can know Jesus Christ as your Savior, your sins be forgiven, we would be delighted to help you with that. But as we say just about every Lord's Day, and I truly mean this, however God speaks to you, would you respond with just a submissive spirit, an obedient spirit, and say, yes, God, I'll do whatever You're speaking to me about.
look this way for a minute before we head to our next hour, to our life application hour. I want to encourage you, if you would like to have some help this morning, maybe as you've heard the preaching of the word, you've begun to wonder, I'm not sure I know Jesus as my Savior. I'm not sure I have a relationship with him. And if that's you, then we would love to help you get that settled today. You could talk to either Pastor Todd or myself or really anyone here. They could point you in the right direction, but we'd like to help you to make sure that you have a relationship with the Lord. I also want to encourage you, if you are new here today, maybe this is your first time, or maybe you've been coming and you've been encouraged by what the Lord is doing here, and I want to encourage you to get some more information about our church. We'd like to help you to know better what the Lord is doing here, and so one of the ways that you can do that is by taking the card in the pew rack in front of you and filling out some basic information. It has the word welcome on top. And if you take that and fill out some information and then take that to the lobby, and then there at the main doors, there are some welcome team members. They have the green lanyards, and so you can hand that card to one of them, and we'll try to get some information to you. And also, we have a gift for you today, so the welcome team members also have that gift. So make sure you do both of those things. And I don't often mention this, but some of you might be wondering how you're able to give to the ministry of our church and abroad. There are three ways you can do that. You can either use the offering boxes in the back of this room as well as in the lobby. They just have a black box there. You can slip that in. Or you can use our website, or you can also use our Church Center Giving app. If you'd like to get set up on that app, feel free to stop me or contact our church office, and we'll try to get you set up on that app. But those are the ways that you can give. Just a few brief announcements before we're dismissed this morning. First of all, in a couple weeks, we are going to be having our long-anticipated men and boys campout. And excited about that. Many have signed up already. Today is the last day to sign up. So if you are interested in that, that sign-up sheet is on the live counter in the lobby. I also wanted to let you know, really looking several months in advance at the Christmas season. Can you believe I just said that? The Christmas season is coming in just a few months. Pastor Curtis is excited about this. And don't start playing Christmas music yet if I'm around, but Pastor Todd will not mind. You know, typically for our Christmas season, we have our adaptation of A Christmas Carol play, and what a great time that is. And this year, we are going to be taking a break from that, really to give our cast and crew members a break. It's a huge endeavor, and so we're going to be taking a break from that. But at the same time, we want to make sure that we keep our focus this Christmas season on reaching out to those around us. The Christmas season is a wonderful opportunity to really reach out to those who may not know Jesus as their Savior. And of course, we do that all year round, but we don't want to forget it this Christmas season. And so this Christmas season, we're going to be having what we're calling our Community Christmas Fest. It will be December 11th. That's a Sunday. Sunday evening, 6 to 8 p.m. in the Family Life Center gym. We'll start off with a time of carol singing and other Christmas songs. Pastor Curtis is going to give a brief challenge, and then we'll split up around the room into different stations, really a station for any age group. We'll have a Christmas Minute to Win It competition, as well as a kids' corner and cookies and cocoa. It's just going to be all Christmas that night. And our goal is, obviously, it's going to be a great time for those of us who are in the church, but our goal is to make this an opportunity to reach out to somebody that the Lord has laid on our heart. Think for a second. Who has the Lord put on your heart that you would love to have the opportunity to share the gospel with? Maybe it's a neighbor. Maybe it's a coworker. Maybe it's a friend of yours. And maybe you've already begun to share the gospel, but you would like more tools, opportunities to connect with that person. That's really what this is about. Now, some of you may remember a couple weeks ago, we said the exact same thing about our bonfire coming up on October 23rd. You remember that? Think of somebody that you can invite to that. So here's my desire, is that over the next few months, perhaps there is one family, one person that you would love to reach out to. You'd love the opportunity to reach out to you. We want these two events, the October 23rd bonfire, as well as our Christmas outreach, to be a tool in your hands to help you to get to know that person. You know, the Lord has laid on Abby and me, our heart. We have a neighbor, dear neighbor near us, sweet family, and yet we're not sure that they know Jesus as their Savior. And so we would like to take these opportunities to invite them and their children to come and join us, spend time with us, and get to know them better. And hopefully, as they meet our church family and see the joy of the Lord, we'll have further opportunities to speak the gospel to them. So here's your homework assignment. I've used that word a few times recently. Here's your homework. Think of and pray about who the Lord would have you to invite to these. And as you pray about this, consider asking them, hey, would you be able to come with me, join me for these events, and pray that the Lord will use this as an opportunity. So mark your calendar, December 11th, that's a Sunday, 6 to 8 p.m. Very excited about this upcoming outreach activity. Also, be sure to come back tonight, 6 p.m. here in this main auditorium. Dwight and Melissa Rooley, our missionaries, will be here, and they will present their ministry, and we'll have the opportunity to hear from them. So be sure to come back tonight, 6 p.m. At this point, you are dismissed to Life Application Hour. If you do not know where to go, please talk to one of the welcome team members, and they will point you in the right direction. May the Lord richly bless you.